grateful to the Alabama Folklife Association for sponsoring this exhibit, which I haven't even totally seen yet, but it's awesome, and for inviting me to share a few thoughts about sacred folk song and the written tradition, that is folk song as a combination of oral and written. And we face that all the time. Here, the first thing you need is to get you a songbook. And, but then we see some older singers who hardly ever look at it. But we use it for some things and we set it down for some things. The 1976 statute, which created the American Folklife Center in the Library of Congress, defined folklife as the traditional expressive culture shared within the various groups in the United States, familial, ethnic, occupational, religious, regional, expressive culture includes a wide range of creative and symbolic forms such as custom, belief, technical skill, language, literature, art, architecture, music, play, dance, drama, ritual, pageantry, handicraft. These expressions are mainly learned orally by imitation or in performance and are generally maintained without benefit of formal instruction or institutional direction. So that's where we have our folklife establishment in the United States. The concept of oral tradition and transmission is an important factor in all studies of folklore, folklife, and folk music. Yet no one can deny that, especially in literate societies, the oral tradition interacts with written forms of transmission. Broadside ballads draw on traditional narratives as well as current events, and these in turn enter the oral tradition once again. While some folk scholars, like Francis James Child of Harvard, tried to exclude ballads suspected of being literary, we cannot ignore the role of written sources in the folk life and folk song of our nation. Nowhere is this more obvious than in the vernacular sacred song of the American South. While George Pullen Jackson established without a doubt that many of the songs in the Sacred Harp were drawn from a wide-ranging oral tradition, the fact remains that we sing from a book with written notation, often singing songs written by our friends and family members. I'd like to trace a little of the history of this interaction and then look at some very specific examples where oral tradition can illuminate the notes and make clearer what we see before us. We can see the beginnings of this interaction in the music of the English Reformation and the origin of lined psalmody or lined out hymns in the 1600s. So in this little brief historical synopsis, among the Calvinist Protestants, the Reformed Protestants in Europe, they have a regulative principle of public worship, which means that any practice not specifically mentioned by the early church in the New Testament was not optional but forbidden. For English Puritans, who have influenced us, these practices included the complex music in many parts sung by professional choirs in cathedrals, accompanied by organ, in royal and university chapels. In fact, we could define that view as thou shalt not. And here's what thou shalt not. Thou shalt not sing in Latin, which pre-Reformation church music was mostly in Latin. Thou shalt not have any choirs, but everybody has to sing. Thou shalt not sing in parts. Everybody has to sing exactly the same. Thou shalt not use instruments. Instruments are mentioned in the Old Testament, but not in praise in the news. So they said no instruments, no tunes of, you know, prior worldly origin. So all the tunes had to be absolutely made specifically for church purposes. And finally, no human poetry. No hymns. Only translations of the Psalms in or other scriptural texts into poetry, were, but not any original hymns by human beings. So what did that lead? And all of those restrictions were quite different from not only the pre-Reformation church, but also the Lutherans and the Church of England and other bodies during that time. So it seemed rather strict. The only thing that could be any stricter was to outlaw church music altogether, which a few did. So only the Psalms of David in metrical translation, sung in unison without accompaniment by entire congregations, is permitted. And you know, when we read the Psalms in the Bible, for example, they are prose. They may use poetic language and poetic imagery, but they don't have a repeated meter that you can sing in different verses. So what I mean, metrical translations, like the 23rd Psalm in one version, in the Bay Psalm book, the Lord to me a shepherd is, want therefore shall not I. He in the folds of tender grass doth make me down to lie. And so that if you have a short tune that can sing that much, then the rest of the psalm is also put into that same meter, so you can just sing it what we call strophic. You can just use the same music over again to sing the rest of the psalm. And so that's what I mean by a metrical translation. So that also, that has to do with the way in which the oral tradition entered English psalmody. When the Puritans gained control of the Church of England in the 1640s, they deposed the bishops and abolished the Book of Common Prayer, and the divines, the clergy, met in Westminster, and in 1644 they said, so that the whole congregation may join in the singing of psalms, everyone that can read is to have a psalm book. But for the present, where many in the congregation cannot read, it is convenient that the minister, or some other fit person appointed by him and the other ruling officers, do read the psalm line by line before the singing thereof. So this practice, known today as lining out, was ostensibly intended as an aid to illiterate worshipers. But there was also a hidden agenda to ease the way for newer translations, newer adaptations of the Psalms to replace the old version, which had been sung since 1562, and which many Puritans thought wasn't quite faithful enough to the Hebrew original. The Puritan colonists in New England approved of these developments. In fact, they had already produced their own psalm version called the Bay Psalm Book in 1640, even before the Westminster Assembly offered a way to implement it. And the Scots Psalter came out in 1650 with another alternative. Regardless of the choice of words, the practice of lining out became universal among English-speaking Protestants in both town and country, in England, Scotland, Ireland, and America. And even after the Church of England returned to prayer book worship in 1662, the only congregational singing most everywhere was the Psalms lined out by a clerk or a precentor and sung in unison without reference to printed notation. But every verse was interrupted several times by the leader, and so any rhythmic impetus and momentum was stopped in its tracks, and it got slower and slower and slower. And each singer waited for his neighbor to move to the next note. And finally, singers began to ornament the long notes with transitions and other figures to make it more interesting to sing. The result was a developing oral tradition that offended the ears of educated clergy and cultural elites. And they reacted by encouraging singing schools, which tried to replace that slow, ornamented, lined-out old way of singing with a new way. And that new way is essentially what we do in the Sacred Harp: singing in parts, reading the notes, following the note values on the page. John Playford, the music publisher, Isaac Watts, and John Wesley, religious poets and leaders, preachers, all called for an end to lining out. The wonder is it has survived for so long and continues today. And so we will hear it and also see some of the tunes in just a moment. But I wanted to read some of the polemic about it, because that it gives some specific things we can listen for when we hear it. In 1720, the presses in Boston were busy distributing sermons and tracts on sacred music. This was a fighting issue for them. Their descriptions are picturesque but one-sided. They regarded the old way of singing as debased and corrupt version of the printed original. Sort of like if you changed the Bible. Thomas Walter in 1721 wrote, "I have observed in many places one man is upon this note while another is on the note before him, which produces something so hideous and disorderly as is beyond expression bad. The tunes are miserably tortured and twisted and quavered in some churches into an horrid medley of confused and disorderly noise." Again, that disorder. "Our tunes, for want of a standard to appeal to in all our singing, left to the mercy of every unskillful throat to chop and alter, twist and change." Thomas Sims wrote, "Hence, you may remember that in our congregation, we frequently used to have some people singing a note or two after the rest had done. And you commonly strike the notes not together, but one after the other. Most," and then listen carefully, "most of the psalm tunes as sung in the usual way are more like song tunes because you have all those supernumerary notes and turnings of your voice in your way than in ours. An ingenious gentleman who has written down a tune called Canterbury, as some of you sing it, finds no less than 150 notes in that tune in your way, whereas in ours, following the book, there are only 30. What did it sound like? Despite all the efforts to stamp it out, we can hear the old way of singing today in the Gaelic-speaking churches on the Isle of Lewis in Scotland. We can hear it in the American South, mainly in the old regular Baptist churches of eastern Kentucky." Now, I have, I'm going to play a recording, but before, look at the example, the first example, the tune, first tune there called Primrose. And it's a tune we all know, Sacred Harp singers all know. And in the tenor line, in the melody of this tune, there happen to be 30 notes. And what we'll hear now, listen to see if you can possibly hear 150 notes in the following recording.
Oh,
Okay. So we heard one verse of it, and this is not a psalm from the colonial period, but it seems this congregation preserves pretty closely the practice described so condescendingly by those Boston ministers. Just about that extent. I mean, about five notes to one or something like that. Here we cannot, the tune is printed first in 1812, but we can't say that the lined out melody is a corrupted version of the printed tune. The tune probably existed long before it was circulated, arranged, and printed by the Chapin brothers. And we're simply looking at two versions of the same tune, one developed in congregational singing, the other in a singing school environment and arrangement. Let's reach out just a little further in our imagination and listen to Amazing Grace. This is not the tune New Britain in the Sacred Harp, but in this, but with this tune, this hymn among old regular Baptists, they use this tune, which we also have a printed version of, arranged by B.F. White, but existing much earlier. Again, follow the tenor line. It's not identical to the lined out version, but we can still follow the contour and many of the notes. And it's not at all what you would expect to find, but it really does follow. Here, this is Amazing Grace.
No wonder we like to sing sometimes. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I want the blood of my mouth when I was crying.
Now we're in the second phrase. Okay, so again, you can get the idea. This is a little further off from the written version, but clearly the same tune. Now, the small white congregations of old regular Baptists who sing in these examples sing only this style of hymn. They don't believe that any other kind of hymn is a legitimate way of praising God. They're very attached to this kind of singing. And if they sing several of the verses, it goes on for a while. But African Americans also preserve the old way of singing in Baptist and Methodist congregations, not only in rural areas or isolated places, but in major cities throughout the United States. But they are not limited to this style of singing. The same churches also have choirs, instruments, diverse styles of music, varying from traditional spirituals and classical selections to contemporary gospel music. But at Wednesday night devotions or choir practice or before the Sunday service, you may hear something like this recorded at a country church in North Mississippi. Do not look for a printed version of this song, even though this tune is the best known of all African American lining hymns. It has no obvious relation to any standard church hymn. And it has many more notes than five per syllable. You'll also hear that, and sometimes in some churches, this is the only lined out tune they know, but in others, they can sing many tunes in many different meters. So this is actually a psalm as adapted by Isaac Watts, and often is called Dr. Watts singing. This is from North Mississippi. That was the first line. So one verse of that is 3 minutes. And if you sang the whole song, well, that one doesn't have too many verses. But you've heard more than you've heard the old, yes?
Is that written out anywhere?
No, sir. Well, there are some articles, ethnomusicology articles, where people have tried to transcribe that, yes.
Are they reading from?
No, a word book. A word book that just has words, like the Lloyd book.
Okay.
Yes. Now, you've heard more than 150 notes, but you've also heard the old way of singing in its purest form, the first form of European music heard and adopted by Africans and their descendants, is now treasured as a legacy from the first African-American ancestors. And people are very reluctant to give that up. I want to change the topic a little. The sounds you heard represent oral tradition and some of the deepest expressions of their respective communities. But I remind you, and I remind myself, recordings are not music. The ethnomusicologist Alan Merriam tried to teach us, but it was a sacred harp that taught me. Recordings are not music. Sounds are not music, despite what your computer says or our culture says, music stores, if they still exist. A folder on my computer saying, my music. Recordings are not music. They only indicate to us what music sounds like. Music is the sum of all the culture, the intentions, the practices, the interactions, the reactions that happen to produce sounds that unite us, identify us, and move us. And recorded sounds are merely a commodity, bought and sold, multiplied, imitated, fueling our economy and helping adolescents in their self-discovery as country fans or rock or hip-hop or alternative. But if sounds were music, sacred harp singers would be able to stay home from singings and listen to digital reproductions. Bruce Springsteen fans would not compelled to follow the boss wherever he tours, reveling in the excitement of each live performance. Recordings are not music, but recordings, whether bought and sold, recorded at a singing or a concert on a cassette player, can comfort us when we can't go to a singing or a live concert, And they can remind us of what we have shared in better times. And we can also learn from recordings. So the main topic I'm talking about is the oral tradition of the Sacred Harp. The book was printed in 1844, and we all own one edition or another. We use the book at every singing. We acknowledge its authority. For some, it's second only to the Bible. But in practice, many of us follow an oral tradition that varies in important ways from the printed page. So this recordings will show that the Sacred Harp oral tradition varies in important ways from the notes on the page. Some of them are local or regional. Some of them are disappearing today as more singers join us who are unfamiliar with the traditions. As long as we grant supreme authority to the notes on the page, I fear we will lose important elements of the oral tradition of Sacred Harp. I even believe in some cases that the oral tradition may reflect the composer's ideals better than the notes on the page, that they knew what they wanted, but maybe not didn't know exactly how to write it down. The first two examples are short ones that just show us some things about the notes and pitches, that we don't use notes from the piano, or we don't use the intervals from a tempered scale. Observers have pointed out for decades, and Thomas Malone in his dissertation explains in new and cogent ways, our minor scale is especially divergent. And I don't want to get into a discussion of Dorian or any other scales. We sing songs, not scales. But I want to play for you the third selection there on the first page as sung by members of the Wooten family in 1982. And there are two things to listen for. One is that all those D sharps are totally ignored. And the other thing is that the, or is it, we got the wrong key. It's the wrong key. It's in F minor, so all the E sharps, which we would really call E naturals there, are ignored. And that the D flats are really seem to be sung closer to D natural. Just hear this one. And also just marvel at the artistry of this 12 members of the family just sitting around in a small square. Let me see. I'm going to skip to where we hear the words there. Here we go. So this is not Dorian or any other Grecian nation, but is characteristic of Sacred Harp singers in almost all parts of the American South. But this is a very special group led by the late Chester Wooten. They're widely acclaimed for their correct and traditional singing, yet this concept of Sacred Harp tonality is widely understood or ignored by many singers today. These variations are debatable, but there's strong evidence that they may go back, this tonal geography goes back many decades, and that B.F. White, the senior compiler, took a very dim view of singing written accidentals, even though he printed them himself. In the next example, I'd just like you to look at the notation. We're not going to hear it. This is a song on page 412 in the Sacred Harp. No, yeah, that is it? No, is it Holy Manna? It's on the second, on the back of page there, Holy Manna. And notice that I have marked in the Sacred Harp copy in some notes in the bass there, three notes in the bass. And I've observed over the years that those three notes are often sung higher, but with the same syllables. In other words, there's instead of so fa 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 la so so, they sing so fa 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 la so so. The shapes are correct, but it seems so natural and even fits better with the other voices that I suspect that the original printing simply misplaced those three notes and that they've been copied without further consideration, and singers ever since have been singing it correctly as A-G-G. One of the few singing masters who did think about those things was William Hauser, and his version is that gray one below, where he prints those three notes the way they are still mostly sung, not the way they were originally written. Should we attempt to sing it as written in our books? Who is right? Don't ask me. But the next example is rhythm and duration. The first example, this is a strictly regional variant in North Mississippi. How, when we sing do, re, mi, not fa, sol, la, and sing the four beats, but very often the first note is a whole note, four beats. But it's only, instead of singing four beats, they sing two beats, down, up, and then start going to the side. And you can hear that very clearly in this recording from about 1972. Let's see. Sorry. Sorry, I didn't get that quite far enough back. E, re, re, so, do, re, mi, fa, mi. Now. So that's, many of us remember those practices, and some still do them. Now the next example is on the page 3, and it's a song that we don't sing very much. And I've marked passages where what it says is, well, heaven and earth his praises ring, Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna to the Lamb of God. The way I have always heard this song is Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the, where the accent fits better, and it also coincides with what the last part where it comes in, Hosanna to the Lamb of God. And I would suspect that Henry Smith Reese might have notated that song better, and that the way the oral tradition may be right and the notation, strictly speaking, not right. Yeah, it's a possibility, something to consider. In the Christian Harmony, by the way, you can see those parts. It goes, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the Lamb of God. Yet a different solution. Okay, now, if I get the right piece here. Yes, James Landrum White took pride in being a scientific modern musician who understood the finer points of sacred music and tried repeatedly to upgrade and update his father's life work. In a song he composed for the new sacred harp in 1884, he produced a notation, though, that is clearly incorrect and inconsistent, but singers understood it just fine, and they still sing it correctly, even though it is notated incorrectly. It was called Nelly in the new Sacred Harp. It was called Emma in the Sacred Harp 5th edition. And then finally, in the 4th edition with supplement in 1911, he called it Willie. Look at the tenor line in the chorus. Can you see that song? Yes, it's at the top of page 4. And in the chorus, it's 6/8, two beats, each a dotted quarter. But in the chorus, the tenor begins a second beat an eighth note late over and over again. So it's, where's the ones that's, oh, home, sweet home, beautiful home. And that's, and where it doesn't agree with the other parts. But the way it's sung and intended is, and here's.
This is one of my favorite songs.
That's Chester Wootton saying it's one of his favorite songs. There's some, I can see the cover of that book right out here called The Colored Sacred Harp by Judge Jackson. And there's a large number of passages where the notation is difficult and sometimes hard to make sense of. But if you look at the piece below called Florida Storm, it's a touching account of a Gulf hurricane in 1926. If you take it literally, there are problems in every verse with all the accents in the wrong place. And it would be hard to sing if all you had to go on was the notes. Fortunately, for Judge Jackson's children and friends and neighbors and the many singers who learned this from them, the song presents no problem. This is a 1993 recording, 17 singers, almost all of them related to Judge Jackson by blood or by marriage. They learned the song directly from the composer. They sing the words confidently, ignoring the printed notation.
Florida Storm. Now, this is a true story. Now, let's see. When I was a boy.
Now, most of the problems come when you try the words. But. I'll go to the word.
Mercy in the star.
Page 5.
God.
okay? You can see there. Once again, the written notation is helpful, but it's not quite there if we really want to learn the song and if we really want to sing it traditionally and movingly.
That's how it goes.
Yeah. Okay, so the final example is by B.F. White himself, and so we will hear it, but then I'm going to ask you to sing it, so because recordings aren't music. But so this is popular and widely sung, and I've heard it sung many times, sometimes more or less as written. But more often, I hear the rhythm sung differently. In this case, you see the marked passages. Notice that the treble has six quarter notes in a row in the treble of the first one of those. But the others have that dotted, the second note is dotted and followed by an eighth note. The way I usually hear it is, come join in and help me to sing. So all of them are quarter notes, but the second quarter note is held as though it has a bird's eye. And this would be a perfectly logical way for a seasoned ballad singer to sing and pause by prolonging a note without having to shorten other notes. And the marked measures, so they become longer than others. And what's written is, for example, in the last phrase, bound by the chords of his love, bound by the chords of his love. But what I usually have heard in the past 35 years is bound by the chords of his love. Listen, one more. This is the last. No, start at 1:17. Now, it's true, I was singing this, but I had just learned this song from Rooney Glover. And she and her brother always sang it this way. There's something else going on in that twill also, where it's wrong. Okay, you can see on those, the melodious twill, melodious should be half note before dotted half, but there it is. There's another song like that called The Christian Warfare, which I used to hear it. I find myself placed in a state of probation. And now I usually hear it just galumphing along the way it's written. We used to assume that our history, like our scripture, was all written down. It took a long time for historians like Walter Prescott Webb and Lawrence Levine to take local and oral history seriously and learn from the people who experienced it. And so I appeal to you, love and respect your songbook. Love and respect your singing school teacher. There are definitely improvements that I've heard in the last 35 years. I remember when, for example, when you had a lot of rests, people would just start beating faster and then come back in at the right speed. What was that? Holy manna. Dun, dun, la, so, fa, so, so, lo, fa, fa, so. Another thing is the way now they teach is to beat that downbeat at the beginning of every measure. That was not commonly done in the old days, and I don't always do it myself, but I see how it improves things, especially songs that start with short pickup notes. One, two, the Lord into his God. That used to be chaotic at the beginning, before people started doing that. So I say that love and respect your songbook, but don't ignore the solid evidence from the oral tradition of our elders. And so finally, I'd like you to sing page 376, and if you have your book, you can even read the alto part for it. And after we sing this song, I'll be happy to take any, if we have a time for a question or comment. So, it's the last page of the handout. Page 5, is it? At the bottom.
Of his love.